year that I'm working on radiation protection of accelerators in operational radiation protection. 20 years now I'm the head of radiation protection unit of the Laboratorio Nazionale di Legnaro, where you have been. And then it's about 5-6 years that I am Italian delegate at the Committee of Radiation Protection and Public Health of the NEA of the OECD. And at the bottom you see my email. As I said, if you have any questions or problems to face, that I can give you some kind of answer, of response, or articles, whatever. Please contact us. It's a little bit difficult to understand what's your level, because maybe it's different. You have a different level, so I prefer to spend some transparencies about radiation protection, because what's radiation protection, some basic concepts. Because radiation protection is a part of accelerators. You cannot put an accelerator, make it work without thinking before how you are going to shield it, how you are going to manage, how you're going to face some problems. And it depends, of course, of the kind of accelerator, of the power of the accelerator, of the ions that you are going to accelerate. So the first thing is, what's radiological protection, and what is dealing with what? Radiological protection, it's a very complicated discipline applied to the protection not only of man, but also to the, of the environment from the possible harmful effects of ionizing radiations. Radiation protection asks for us to have some knowledge about on physics, chemistry, biology, law, and also ethic concepts. All the radiological protection is based on three principles. These are the cardinal system of radiation protection. Justification of a practice means that you cannot put the practice on with ionizing radiation if you before, at the very beginning, justified it and you demonstrate that you cannot do it, this kind of practice, without using ionizing radiation. Otherwise, it's not justified. And you have also to reconsider it after some years, just to understand if there are changes in the knowledge. The second principle, the most known as ALARA, as low as achievable, reasonable achievable. Anyway, that means that you must optimize the radiation protection. You have to do whatever, taking into account economical and social aspects. You have to reduce the dose. You have to put some constraints, as they are considered, that they are far below the limits. And the third one is individual dose limits, that in any practice, someone, a personnel or a group of individuals cannot go over the dose, the limit of the dose that has been fixed. What's the main problem of radiation protection? The main problem of radiation protection is to define quantities that they have to quantify the exposure risk to the different type of ionizing radiation. What I have to know, if I'm exposed to neutrons or gammas or a mixed field, what I want to know is what's the biological risk that I'm going to have. These quantities, therefore, serve as indicators of radiation risk and allow a satisfactory preventive strategy to be given. That means that based on the quantities, I have to think about what kind of asset I have to give. Which are these quantities? There are physical quantities, radiation protection quantities, and operational quantities. The physical quantities are quantities that they are exactly measurable. You can measure them. The radiation protection quantities defined by ICRP are not directly measurable. It has to deal with average values and give you an idea about the biological effect. And the operational quantities that they are defined by ICRU, they are used for environmental and personal monitoring. And on the basis of these quantities, I can define the radiation protection quantities. The physical quantities, you know them, it's the fluence, number of particles per surface, and the rate per second, and this is perfectly measurable. The absorbed dose, that is the ratio between the average energy imparted or transferred by the radiation to the matter divided with the mass of the volume considered, and the unit is gray, 1 joule per kilogram. Mostly used is the rate of the absorbed dose in gray per second or under multiple like milligray per hour or microgray per hour and so on. Then the Kerm, of course, that has to deal with indirectly ionizing particles like neutrons and gammas, and it's the kinetic energy released in the matter defined by the quotient between the sum of the initial kinetic energies and all the charged particles produced by indirectly ionizing particles in a center volume element of a specified material and mass dm, and the unit is the same, and passing to radiation protection quantities, there is the average absorbed dose by an organ of the body or tissue, and it's defined, as you see, as the average absorbed dose in an organ indicated by the DTR, and this is the reason that it's not a measurable quantity, because you have to deal with an average absorbed dose in an organ that you cannot measure it. After this, you have to deal with the equivalent dose. That means that comes out from the question, if I give an equal absorbed dose, like, for example, 1 gray of neutrons or 1 gray of gammas, what will be the biological response? Will be the same or will be different? The answer is that will be different. That means that the radiation has different quality for in parity of dose for biological effects. And this is exactly saying by this quantity and by this product, where if D is the same, this one changes according to the values of the weighting factor for radiation. If you are in a mixed field, of course, you will have the sum. The unit is sievert or under multiples like microsievert per hour, the rate, microsievert per hour or millisievert per hour and so on. To pass to the next quantity, the question is, okay, but if I gave the same dose to an organ, to different organs, I will have the same response or not. That means there is any different sensitivity, sensibility of the organs, or are all the same? To take into account, take a look about what's the value of WR. For photons and gammas, by definition, is 1, electrons 1, alphas 20, protons 5, and then on neutrons depends on the energy. Having from 100 kV to 2 MeV a maximum of 20, and then goes down. And then goes down the value of the weighting factor. Why? Because the energy of the neutron is so high that did not see your body pass through without interacting. So if the absorbed dose is equal to 1 gray and you have different weighting factors, the equivalent dose is different and you have to multiply 1 gray with one of these numbers. So you see that for photons 1 gray is 1 sievert, but for alphas is 20, and for neutrons depends on the energy, you will have a greater number anyway. Going to the different sensibility of the organs, also here we have a weighting factor of the tissue of the organ according to his sensibility. That means, like before, you remember this weighting factor for radiation, now we have a weighting factor for organ, for tissue or organ, whatever, and this value is different according to different organs of the body. You can see it here. For gonads, is, according to ICTP-60, it's 0.20. Then for bone marrow, colon, lung, and so on. And of course, the total body is 1. These are the reminders. That means different organs or tissue, and every one of these is 0.5. On this column, you see something interesting that has to be understood, in the sense that if I have an exposed worker and we take 100 persons and they give him during their life 1 sievert, that is a very big quantity, only 6 of them will have a fatal cancer due to the radiation. Taking into account that in a work dangerous, like constructing buildings and go up in height, you have 1 death every 10,000 people working.
Excuse me.
Yes.
These tissue factors were measured experimentally or not?
They are WT, you mean?
Yes, yes.
WT coming out from calculation, but also from the experience from radiation therapy.
Over the many years.
During many years, and also from workers that they are exposed in different, like miners and so on.
Not measurable quantities that you mentioned, right?
The ICRP quantities and CCRU quantities are non-measurable.
Not measurable.
No.
Quantities. They were. This data was collected over the many years.
Like no, we will see how they do it. I will tell you. Yeah. After ICRP 60. There is ICRP-103 that changed some importance of the weighting factor for tissue. You see, one of the most important is that the gonad goes down from 0.20 to 0.05. This is our experimental results coming, You know that also from the survivors from Nagasaki and Hiroshima, there are a lot of commissions that during years they review all the data and they give different values on a lot of things like weighting factor for neutrons, weighting factor for tissues and so on. I'm coming to your question. What they do really, I mean, one is thinking about, okay, when someone tells me what's my dose, the quantity is the effective dose. And the effective dose is by definition non-measurable. And the question is, if it's not measurable, what are you giving me? Okay. Now we will see. What is given to you in effective dose is something coming from here, from the monitoring, in the sense that your dose is related to ambient dosimetry, that means I put, excuse me, near you a monitor that is measuring. So what I'm going to take from the monitoring is, let's suppose, what you got. Or I give you a personal individual monitoring. So the read, if I read it, what I get is very close to what you got. But not only. What they are doing is, if you ever read ICRP, you will see that most of the job is done by Monte Carlo calculations. They have the phantoms, OECRU sphere, or other anthropomorphic phantoms like Adam and Eva, where according to the type of irradiation that they have, it's, if it's direct irradiation or from the back to the front or lateral and so on, they use this kind of phantoms and they make calculation about the dose. They get factors that can they have to be multiplied with the fluence to get the dose, and what they know, and this is according also to experimental data coming from a lot of facilities, is that in all cases of gamma radiation except the part of the X-rays that they are near 30, 40, 50 kV, in a mixed field, you are always underestimated the dose when you talk about effective dose. Only in the case of monoenergetic photons of 30, 40, or 50 kV, you can have an underestimation of the dose. And the same for neutrons, because for you, it's extremely difficult to find a place where you have monoenergetic neutrons. Generally, out of the reactors, out of the accelerators, you have continuous spectra of neutrons. And there, they have, except, again, some cases of low energy monoenergetic neutrons, you always underestimate the dose with effective dose. So when you measure the operational quantities, the protection quantities is always underestimated. So in the presence of a radiation source, what you have personal dosimetry and you have ambient dosimetry in the environment, what you measure with the monitors. What are the quantities in these two cases? It's the ambient dose equivalent, what it said, H star D, and personal dose equivalent, HPD. This D is not other than the depth where you are going to measure the dose. because when when D is equal to 10 millimeter, you are considering penetrating radiation, so gammas and neutrons. In the case of D equal to 0.07 millimeter, you are talking about a skin radiation on the tissue because, for example, of soft X-rays and so on, or betas. Just to understand what is Abend dosimetry, you have to have in mind some definitions, what is a real field, an expanded field, an unidirectional and expanded field. Otherwise, you cannot understand what is dealing about the Abend dose equivalent, because the Abend dose equivalent, for by definition, is the dose equivalent in a point. In a point, and when you are in a point and not in a medium of a tissue, you can measure. In a point of a radiation field that would be produced by the corresponding expanded and unidirectional field of this Eros sphere at a depth d on the radius opposite to the direction of this unidirectional field. The recommended, as I told you before, distance is 10 millimeter, and this defined penetrating radiation. In the case of directional equivalent dose, aka HD omega, like solid angle, you are talking about surface radiation and also radiation of the lens of the eye, and is and you have common recommended depth 0.07 millimeter, and you are dealing not with not anymore with expanded and unidirectional field, but you are dealing only with the corresponding expanded field in the ICRU sphere. About personal dosimetry, personal dose equivalent, also here you have D with 10 millimeter recommended and 0.7 for skin and eyes, lens of the eye. And the last one is what is going on when you introduce in your body radioactive material. So when you introduce in your body, you are dealing with internal irradiation, and so with effective dose that takes into account also not only external global or partial radiation, but also the contamination. In this case, the quantity is the committed equivalent dose, and this is with respect to time. It's defined in a tissue or organ, T, that will be received by an individual. And this kind of time from introduction up to the calculation of the dose is taking into account that it's 50 years. So if someone introduces in the body, let's say, 1 becquerel of americium, and one is saying, for this introduction, you got 10 microsievert, means that you got 10 microsievert from now up to when it will be 2069. Okay? If more than one organ is involved, of course, you have the sum of the committed of effective dose. And of course, this committed effective dose goes inside the total effective dose that is composed from external radiation and internal radiation. If the internal radiation is zero, because you don't have, for example, not sealed material, you will only have external radiation. But if you have also introduction of radioactive material in your body, you will have the sum, external plus internal. And the question is, if let's suppose that, for example, someone is working in a lab, has no external radiation, something is happening and introducing his body only radioactive material. Someone is making the calculation and saying, you got 10 microsieverts. Okay. Another one is exposed to gammas or to neutrons, only like external radiation. And someone is saying your effective dose is 10 microsieverts. These two people that they get effective dose, one from internal and the other from the external, the same effective dose, they have the same risk to get a biological effect or different risk because one is internal and the other is external?
Internal, it must be much worse.
It must be much worse. Why?
Yeah, because if it's internal, you have a very high probability of that particle interact with your body. If it's external, maybe.
What do you think?
It depends on the particle.
You agree? It has nothing to do. It's the same. From the definition of effective dose. You remember? The effective dose, like a definition, if I go back. It's here. The effective dose take into account whatever happens in your exposure, internal, external, whatever. It's the sum of all of your exposures. It's a number that is related with risk. So it doesn't matter how it comes out, if it's because of internal or external exposure. Of course, it's not taking into account the toxicity of the element, because there is also the chemical toxicity of the element, but it's not taking into account in this case. We are talking only on dose. Once you have defined the effective dose, you have defined everything that is related with your exposure, internal, external, it is, or the sum, doesn't matter. Okay, so this is important. Let's go now to see something that I don't know if you know about it. What are the limits? There are the workers and there are the people, the population, the public. The exposed workers, they have an effective dose limit of 20 millisievert per year, at least in Italy. That means that the exposed worker, that they are A or B, they have the same limit. It doesn't matter if they are catalogized in A or B. It's a question of other type of things. Let's say one can be visited by a doctor every 1 year, the other one six months every year, and so on. But the limit of those that they have, it's the same, 20 millisieverts per year. Non-exposed workers, it's not a very good definition. It's not that someone is not exposed to radiation. It's someone that, because of his job, he can take 1 millisievert per year. And this is the same of the public. Then there are some partial limits on length of the eye. This is also changed with the new directive, European directive, that considers the length of the eye more a stochastic effect and not any more deterministic effect. And this value is from 150 becomes 20. Then arm legs, they have, as you can see, a very high value. Why they have a very high value? Because they have a weighting factor for tissue very low, 0.01. And then there is equivalent dose due to contamination, due to exposure, excuse me, on the surface of the tissue, and it's considered in 1 cm², where you can get 500 millisievert per year. Very often this is related if you have an accident with X-ray tube or something very focused, like a beam on your skin and so on. So these are the main limits that, at least in Europe, according to ICRP 60, are now in, we're working with them. Let's go on saying this part, general part, and we are going to see the radiation protection at low energy proton accelerators, because going to accelerators that they are, you have heavy ions, it's another part, but depends of course of the type of the ion, energy and current, but it's less dangerous in some way from the proton accelerators. The overview of the presentation is an introduction, then what's prompt radiation, the interaction of protons with matter, nuclear interactions, characteristics of prompt radiation field, attenuation. This is extremely important, for example, to design your shielding. Induced radioactivity, once your machine is working, the radioactivity when the beam is off remains, it's the induced radioactivity. Magnitude and prediction, it's extremely important because we have to plan how to make maintenance on your machine. Then environmental impact when you work, like the phenomenon of neutron sky shining, and that means the shielding of the roof of your accelerator, some aspects of emission of radioactive effluents, and the summary. What we call in radiation protection low energy and intermediate energy, we are here, up to 100, up to 1 JV, and maybe less to 1 JV of protons in energy. Then it's considered high proton accelerators. The schemes of the accelerators that are available are extremely different, from RFQs to first cyclotrons and very big cyclotrons like this one of Vancouver, then Vantagraphs that you have already seen, and DTLs and so on. There are many applications of the accelerators, from research to radiotherapy, industrial and medical radioisotope production, waste transmutation like ADS, and also detection of contraband. You see a typical scheme here, where from the reaction P on carbon 13, you have a gamma of high energy, if I don't mind, more than 8 MeV. And so you can, with this reaction, you can search for contraband explosives and so on. Difficult to do it outside, because the farmers, they use nitrogen for fertilizers, so you can try to find bombs, but you can find other things, so I don't know what is the meaning. Excuse me. The interaction of proton with matter, low energy energy loss by ionization. In high energy, you have energy loss by nuclear interactions. In nuclear interactions, you have direct interactions, pre-equilibrium and equilibrium evaporation. Characteristics of the prompt radiation field. There are. I'll give you some also equation or rules of thumb that can be interest to solve some quickly some problems that you can face. Interaction of protons with matter in low energy protons. We define a range that. In high energy, the range is not meaningful anymore. The range is in iron, you can see it here. And for other materials, you can calculate it from this equation. The probability of interaction, of nuclear interaction, as you see here, it's in the fraction of proton energy from low energies up to 1 GeV, the probability is going up, and you see here the different materials where the proton is impinging on, and you can arrive almost to 1, where at high energies every proton undergoes nuclear interaction if the target is thick enough, so to stop the beam inside the target. Of course, in the case of the protons that stop the beam inside the target, we are refer also to Bragg peak. To Bragg peak, that is extremely interesting in application of proton therapy because you know exactly where you lose the maximum of the energy of the beam. And let's go to characteristics of prompt radiation field. Because when the protons interact with the target, you have secondary particles that they are produced, that they going from neutrons up to gamma rays passing from protons, depending on the energy, more than quite 500, 450 MeV, pions, muons, electrons, neutrinos that they don't have charge and mass, so they didn't give particularly problems in radiation protection. And going to nuclear interaction, you can see that the first part is the evaporation here with the direct directions up in energy. This is a schematic spectrum of emitted particles. And the energy spectrum of evaporate particles, especially neutrons, you see it's focused up to the first 8 MeV energy. I mean, when evaporation of neutrons coming out in a two-step process, first you have all the particles that they are directly emitting from the interaction, and then you have also neutrons coming from evaporation. The neutrons coming out only from nuclear reactions, then in these cases, you are because they have charge, you have energy loss by ionization. The same electrons, here you have no charge, so you lose energy between the three processes that they are known, and neutrinos practically you have no interaction, and the interaction of prompt radiation coming from an accelerator with the matter, the most important thing are the neutrons in the shielding that they can penetrate very efficiently, they have no charge, and all the other charged particles they are stopped inside the thickness of concrete, for example, like a shielding. So that's why often we say that when you have shielded the accelerator for neutrons, you have also shielded the accelerator also from other radiation, like gammas or charged particles, because anyway they are ranged out.
Does it apply if you use other methods of shielding against the neutron.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, maybe you are using a low weight material
mm-hmm.
To shield the neutron.
Mm-hmm.
Would you be shielding the protons and the rest as well?
Yes. Okay. Yes, yes. If you. In accelerator, proton accelerator, when you shield neutrons, you have shielded also gammas. If someone is going to ask me, but why even if 3 or 4 meters of concrete, I can find some gammas outside? How it's possible? Or some neutrons. If you have neutrons of high energy, you have a probability that the neutron will undergo inside different interaction, and some of them, they can arrive just in the surface of the concrete with a thermal energy that can be absorbed, for example, from material. And when you create a nuclide that is excited, then the gamma that's coming out did not find a sufficient layer to be shielded, and so you have gammas. In the same way, even if you have 3 or 4 meters of concrete, you can find neutrons outside, because it's a statistical process. Some neutrons of high energy, even if they go interaction, they will have at the end sufficient energy to go outside of the shell. In a complicated situation for the shielding of accelerators, you cannot use anymore NCRP-51, even if it's a very good book of reference book. But in the scheme complicated of shielding, you have to use Monte Carlo codes. Without Monte Carlo codes, it's not anymore possible to work. Most of them, like MCMP or MCMPX for higher energies than 20 MeV, or Light or Fluca or Mars, they are doing different jobs, or they use different nuclear models, but they are the tools that they have to be used anyway. Here you see an example. For example, a 30 MeV radioisotope production from a cyclotron, and in the different colors done in a geometry that's inside, that you create inside the Monte Carlo, you can have an idea in the point of interaction of the beam, what is going all around your shielding once you have defined the thickness of the shielding, and you can have an idea what's the rate that you can expect. When you are dealing with shielding calculations, and remember always that the pen and the paper, and do it by your hand, I mean, it's always valuable in some situations. The main equation for shielding is this one, where this is the dose rate that I need, the equivalent dose rate, that the ambient dose, the ambient equivalent dose rate for neutrons, for example, that I need, the energy of the proton, the angle between the target, here is the proton beam, and I want to know what's going on here. This is the angle, and this is the reference value of the dose. That means what's the dose that I have 1 meter from the target, generally speaking. And then you have the lambda, that is the mean free path. And this is the distance between the proton beam and the target, the point of the source, and the point of my detector, the point of interest. And always, you know, and as we'll see, these numbers, lambda, is already calculated for most of the cases, and so you can find it in the literature. In the case in which you have a shield and you want to know something in this 90 degrees, name TESH is a famous German radiation protection man that you can search in internet, and you can find his publications. So at 90 degrees from the source, what you have is this expression to calculate the dose, and this ACA cascade, it's not other than this value that you can calculate it expressed in picosievert in the function of proton energy. Also, this value, density, multiply lambda in concrete, you can find it here. And as you see, many people have made calculations, and they are very near to this curve. So they are dose attenuation length in the function in x-axis you have the proton energy in MeV. Here you have also a value of density multiplying lambda 10. Lambda 10 is not other than 10th value layer. That means the thickness that you from 1 to go to 1/10 of the dose. And you see, for various reactions that are type PN or DN or helium 3N reactions, where they are in a function of the incident particle energy. Excuse me. Here we are. Okay. Here you have some equivalent formulations of dose attenuation. That means the reference at 1 meter, and what I have, what I need, or what I want to have, so that I can calculate my thickness of the shielding. And you see attenuation length, half value layer, and 10th value layer, and these are the relationships between them. This is the dose attenuation length in concrete, given by NCRP 51 and also by other researchers that they have made the calculations. Dose attenuation length in versus proton energy, and this is a famous coming from also NCRP, more recent, about accelerators, that give you the neutron attenuation length up to the higher energy limit, where you arrived at a certain value where you don't have any more increase. And let's pass now to radioactivity induced in targeted structures. Just two rule of thumbs, just to have an idea. In accelerator, the saturation activity coming from 0.1 to 1 megawatt, that means multiply energy with current of the accelerator, you are near to 1,000, 10,000 terabecquerel. That means 6 terabecquerel per kilowatt, when in a fission reactor the at saturation you have 50 terabecquerel per kilowatt of power. Residual fields of components in total radioactivity produced in thin targets, not thick, thin targets. You have here some some ideas what you are going to expect per proton current in Becquerel per gram per square centimeter, and in the range of current from 1 to 10, when you go up from 1 to 10 microamp of current, when you are in some tens or hundreds of maybe remote handling of the piece that is activated is needed. And of course this goes up with the cost of the facility. How I can determine induced radiation field? I don't know if you know this guy of 1950, 54, 55, Barbier. You can find the book in internet. There is an extremely detailed procedure how you can go to calculate the total dose rate, starting from the input target element or compound, activity from cross sections, look up gamma ray library fluxes and so on, and so you have an idea what kind of activation can you expect in different cases and different materials. How can you determine induced radiation fields in experimental way? If you have a monitor, an ion chamber, you can measure the total dose rate from the piece, from the block of whatever it is. Then if you have a high pure germanium and you shield it just to take only the part that coming from the activated part, you have the gamma spectrum, and going all around this procedure, you can have the possibility to calculate the induced radiation fields for arbitrary radiation history. And this is useful for what? For shutdown and maintenance planning and for decommissioning planning of your facility. For example, here is a 500 MeV cyclotron exam coming from Triumph, where they have here the rate in milligrays and the time in days. And here you have the beam current in microamps. And the last part is an extremely interesting part on environmental impact, including sky shine of radiation and release of effluents in air and water. What's the sky shine? You know that if you don't have a sealed upper your facility, your machine, and you have a high production of neutrons, the neutrons from the source coming out interacts with the air, and you can find your neutrons, your detector, in a certain distance from your facility that can be also hundreds of meters away. This is because you have the interaction of the neutrons in the air with nitrogen, oxygen, and so on. And this, as you see, these cross sections are not so low. Especially when you have high energy neutrons, you can have distances that goes up and up. Meanwhile, low energy neutrons can stay inside the sphere. In first approximation, the dose that you are going to have in a certain distance is, this is the source term in neutrons at the point of emission, and in a certain distance R, you will have a dose rate coming from this equation. The spectrum, of course, hardens with the distance. If you have high energy neutrons, as we said, we will find them very far away. So be careful. We need always to calculate the shielding at the roof of our accelerator. Otherwise, you will find problems and will be. And if you are in a situation that you cannot shield with blocks your target inside the room, you will have a lot of problems because you could not anymore put a roof at the roof existing of your building. Emission of radioactive effluents in air and water. See this thing? This is dealing with a typical active cooling water system where you have a high active circuit, cooling circuit coming from a Tiger collimator. And here you have resins that exchange, this is a double system closed, exchange the water with the resins. Of course, tritium is not absorbed with the resins because substitutes hydrogen in the water, and you can keep only this kind of radioactive elements here to create inside the water. And then there is another active of low conductivity water, another system that gives cooling to beamline magnets, vacuum pumps, cavities, and so on, that is made in such a way that you can also evaporate the water and leave the radioactive elements inside containment, because the water evaporates, of course, and the radioactive parts remains inside. In the case of some kind of losses of the material, it has to be, you have to think about a containment where the water can finish because it will be activated, and so a closed sump. And all these things, to create them is not, you have to foresee before, because otherwise it's not so simple to create after in the facility. A typical design of drain system is this one, where there are different, as you see, sumps from a local to a central and so on, with level alarms where you when you arrived at a certain height, you have to, there is a level alarm. You can measure here if you don't have so much radioactivity, or the radioactivity is decay, you can send it to the central active sump where it can remain still with level alarm and so on. And if it decays, you can take some of him and you can put to a, you can take it out. And if you don't have, you are under the concentration of the radioactivity that the law of the country where you are permits, you can also. You can also throw it away. This operation in Italy is extremely strictly. You cannot send anything that it's over 1 becquerel per gram, so it's quite nothing. And the last transparency is with. With a vacuum exhaust system, complicated, especially in facilities where there are radioactive beams, where there is a two-barrier vacuum, a primary one, a primary and a secondary one, and then storage tanks where the pumps from along the beam, from the secondary vacuum, takes the gases and they put it in these tanks where you can calculate the time of decay, and then to put some of the gases to another and to another one, waiting long term period, so the radioactivity high level can decay, and so in a certain way you can throw it away, or by using HEPA filters or particulates, or if you are in the presence of iodine, or of halogens that they are radioactive, you can use charcoal filter to trap them, and then if it's permitted, the measurement that you do before the chimney permitted, it you can send it to the environment.
But one question in the last one, what's the radioactive element there? It's a powder.
Where exactly? Here.
Yeah, there.
Well, here the primary vacuum is the vacuum of the target.
But what's the radioactive?
For example, in the RIB facility, you have fission and you have everything. You have everything means all the iodine, radioactive. What if you make fission from neutrons on uranium, for example? It's the same as you do it by protons. You can the same means you can have some difference in the fission curve. It could be more or more attenuate, more going down or more flat, but you will have all the krypton, the xenon, the iodine, the halogens,
yeah, but in terms of
the cesium,
how
of radioactivity.
Normally, when you make a nuclear reaction in laboratory conditions, the amount of particles that you're generating is, let's say, in the order of 10 to 8.
In this case, I can tell you that with 35 grams of uranium carbide sinterized, you can have 1,000 and irradiated 14 days with protons of 40 MeV and 200 microamps. You have 10 to the 13 fissions, and you have 1,000 curies after 14 days of irradiation. The number, for example, of noble radioactive gases that you produce is 10 to the 13. So it's not. It seems, but it's enough. This is this is important. Generally speaking, when you have the possibility to have release of radioactive material, you must be under pressure, or better, you have to create at least two barriers of under pressure. For example, in our case, in our lab, in our facility, for what we are doing, we have in the bunker of irradiation minus 80 Pascal, in the room before minus 40, and then atmospheric pressure. So if you're going to lose a barrier, there is another one. Otherwise, the radioactivity is going around. And this is sketching here. Radioactive air, you are in low pressure. To create low pressure, you have to have a fan that takes out the air to create the depression, under pressure. So the question is this one: how many number of air changes I have to do? A lot in an hour, for example, or not? The answer is here from these two graphics, where this one you arrive to one because you arrive to one because as fast as you take it out, it is creating. And you see that high ventilation rates reduce the radioactivity level in the room where you produce it, but increase with the amount of radioactivity that you are bringing outside of the facility. So you have to find the gold number where you are creating the pressure that you want with a minor number of air changes. This is a mathematical approach that if someone of you is interested, we can change it. You can send it to you, so you will see exactly which are the equations and how you face it. So, in summary, we have described some specific application in proton therapy, direct interactions, evaporation, shielded intermediate energies, semi-empirical types measurements, Skynstein emission radiation effluence. Remember that when you have a reaction with a proton beam impinging on a target, most of the time it's in the direction of the beam that you will have concentrated the major number of neutrons. In the case of the evaporation of neutrons, because of the excited state of the system, the evaporation is going of the neutrons with maximum energy of 8 MeV. It's going to be distributed in an isotropic way and not pick up in the 0 degree direction compared with the beam. I go out at least 15 minutes.
No, we started late.
Please.
Yes, my question should be maybe a little bit out of the scope of the lecture, but I'm wondering my first question is, what is the timeline of a...
Which is there?
The timeline of a nuclear reactor central. I mean, when you have a
facility?
A facility.
But how long?
How long should it last first? And do you include into the system of radiological protection the...
Decommissioning?
The demolition.
Decommissioning.
The demolition.
This is a very interesting question. I don't know if you heard what he said. He said, if you have a facility, a radiation facility of a certain importance, radiological importance, how long this facility is designed to operate? And of course, if you have to think before about the decommissioning of the facility. This is an extremely important issue, not only how to manage it after, but also from the economical point of view. When you create a facility, at least you are thinking to make it work at least for 30 years, especially if it costs millions of euros. Taking into account that a nuclear reactor is thought to work about 30 years, but then nobody stop it, so they take let's say periods of 10 years into 10 years to go on. No? So this is the first part. The second part, that is not second, but it's also first of the first, is when you construct a facility, you must to think immediately about the decommissioning of the facility. And this is asked, for example, from the Italian law, to make a plan of how you think to decommission the facility. Why? In our case, for example, when you have 40 MeV of neutron, 40 MeV of protons with 200 microamps, 10 to the 14th neutrons impinging on the walls of a bunker, first, then you have uranium carbide inside there, so you have fission. You are able and you are so, let's say, technically good to confine all the material, but it's not the case because some of the material you are going to lose it all around the bunker. So you have to think, how can there are any actions that I can do from the very beginning in the phase of building the facility so to make the costs less And the answer is yes. For example, in Italy, you cannot throw away concrete that it's activated. And if you go to search in the literature, you will see what you imagine that a concrete produce. Because concrete is made from carbon, hydrogen, and some element, trace element materials. One of these trace element materials most important is europium. Europium change in europium 152 that has a half-life of 12 years or so on. So when you create europium inside the concrete and you have so low concentrations of 1 becquerel per gram, otherwise you cannot throw it away, you have to keep it. So you have to think that if I make a wall altogether of 5 meters or 4 meters or 3 meters, then what I'm going to make this kind of wall? I cannot throw it away. But if I can calculate with Monte Carlo after a certain period of time, like say 20 years, with 20,000, with 5 or 20,000 hours a year of operation, I can calculate up to what thickness I will have this kind of products. So I can build my shielding in slices. So if I know that up to 1.5 meters I will have this kind of problems, after that, if I make a slice of 1.5 meters and then another one, one it remains and the other I throw it away, I make something else. Not only, but in our case of radioactive radioactive beams, when you will have contamination, can you and you have also alpha contamination, because when you make the fission inside there, you have also neptunium, you have also other things that they are alpha emitters. If you lose it in the concrete in the downstairs, it is going to go inside, and you cannot take it out in the contamination anymore. But if you think to paint the whole bunker with appropriate material that it's easy to decontaminate it, then you will take it out when you finish your facility and the other thing will be clean. Otherwise, you are going to spend so much money that you cannot imagine. The decommissioning is one part, extremely important from the money point of view. Can cost more than the bill.
May I suggest, because the ladies are waiting for the coffee break, to continue the questions after the coffee break?
Si, si. Yeah?